Several years ago, my two daughters were at Heartland Baptist Bible College, and they went to a church planners conference. And they said, "Dad, if you never go to anything else at Heartland Baptist Bible College, you've got to go to the church planners conference." They said, "It's the most amazing thing you've ever seen. People giving money, getting excited, students standing up, giving away tuition money to see people plant churches around the country." And then they told me the story about some wild preacher man that was planting a church in Philadelphia, and a story about a motorcycle getting stolen, and the drug dealers tell him, "Take that back, that's a good church, you leave that motorcycle alone." And about speakers blaring out the word of God to the neighborhood in the inner city, Philadelphia. And so I thought that was some interesting things. You know, you listen to your kids, you know, and they were excited and they were fired up. A couple of years later, a couple of folks that were members of our church, he got transferred to the Philadelphia area. They started coming back and telling stories about this church that was being planted in inner city Philadelphia. They started visiting here. They started, and they told the same story about the motorcycle. I said, "That's got to be the same church." And so they knew Brother Gates. It was Brother England and his wife, Melissa. And so we called Brother Gates, had him come over, and he preached at our missions conference about probably 4 or 5 years ago. And so we were a little late getting in on what God was doing here, but we got in on it because we were excited about the church plan here. And so we were just really excited to get to meet Brother Sister Gates. And then I want to thank the church because you've been sharing them with us the last couple years in the summertime for our senior camp. Amen. And I know sometimes when the pastor goes out of town, leaves and preaches away, you don't realize the impact that's having on other people around the world. I've been at the conferences where Pastor Gates has preached over there in Oklahoma. And listen, they just need a touch of Philadelphia every once in a while out in the West just to straighten them out. And he comes over, preaches at our youth camp, and then on Wednesday nights we sneak him into our church. And our church needs shaking up every once in a while. Amen. And so we enjoy having him over there. And so I want to just personally thank you for sharing him. I want to. And then when I was a teenager, 44 years ago, I rode a church bus 28 miles one way. Now, he promised, the driver came to my neighborhood, and he promised a 10-speed bicycle to the person who brought the most visitors. In the church that we went to, it ran 600 of them came on buses. I mean, they had some bus ministry all over the state of Illinois. But I went to win a 10-speed bicycle. He's driving out in the country for about 30 minutes. I think he's going to take me out in the cornfield and kill me. I'm never going to see my family again. But anyway, I was 12 years old. I rode that bus. And that Sunday morning, I didn't win a 10-speed bicycle, but I got gloriously saved. Right. A reservation in heaven, and been serving the Lord ever since. So I appreciate the bus ministry. I was saved as a result of the bus ministry. But in that church that a few years later with that pastor, there was a young boy running around. His dad and I went to church together. I was a teenager. He was a young boy. His name was Paul Coyle. Then I heard that he was over here. And so it just seemed like there were connection after connection. And so we're excited about the opportunity to actually get to come and see and visit and be a part of. We came today, and we spent about 15-20 minutes standing around waiting for Brother Gates to get there. I told everybody, "I'll come over here, do whatever the Lord calls, as long as he's standing close to me when he's packing." Okay? 15-20 minutes, we're standing on the street corner. I can tell some people are looking and saying, "Who are those guys and what are they doing in this neighborhood?" And then before we got here, we got into town, we forgot to stop and eat, so we're driving around looking for an Arby's in inner city Philadelphia with a Garmin, you know, and we're all, but we finally found the new Burger King over here. It's a great place, got a sandwich, you know, across from Ronald McDonald House, the hospital over there, and so we did that. Then, after looking at the new buildings and stuff, we headed back to our motel at 5 o'clock in inner city Philadelphia, or in the city of Philadelphia. So we did everything wrong that you're supposed to do when you go to the city, but we're grateful for that. And listen, we're from Western Week. Tim and I, we've been to Haiti, we've been to Brazil, we've been worked with different folks all over the world, and you know, coming here, it's been just as exciting to see what God's doing right here in what we say is inner city Philadelphia. You come to West Virginia. I came from Illinois. I came out to West Virginia in 1981 to be the assistant pastor of the church that I'm now the senior pastor of. For 5 years, for 10 years I was missionary, 18 years senior pastor, 35 years we've been with this church. And when I left Illinois, I came from the city of Springfield. We called it a city. It was 100,000. I mean, we thought it was a city. Yeah. But anyway, I came to West Virginia. And listen, West Virginia was hard for me. I mean, it was trees, and it was we were coming in. There was a sign that said Lost Creek. I said, "Well, where'd they lose it? Why don't they find it?" You know, there was Raccoon Run. I mean, you just can't, you know. So I'm still, after 35 years, I was 21 years in Illinois, 35 years in West Virginia, and they still call me a Yankee. because I wasn't born in West Virginia. So there's culture everywhere, but we're glad to be here. And I want to invite your attention to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, we're going to read just four verses here in a moment. Acts 13, verses 1 through 4. And again, I appreciate those who are physically able to stand in respect for the reading of God's Word. Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 4. If I was to title this, I'd call this a commissioned congregation. A commissioned congregation. And we're going to look at some things here in Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 4. This is a very defining moment in the beginning of what we would call the church. Understanding the book of Acts in chapter 2 is where the Holy Spirit empowers the church. I believe the church was started in the ministry of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, but it was empowered at Pentecost. But then the expansion of the church is throughout the book of Acts. I know Acts is the Acts of the Apostle, but it is the story of the church, the local church growing and God expanding it. And so we're going to look at a defining moment here. Verse 1 of Acts chapter 13 says, "Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manaen, which was been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. Verse 2, as they ministered to the Lord and fasted, the Holy Ghost said, Separate me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work whereunto I have called them. And when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. So they being sent forth by the Holy Ghost departed unto Seleucia, and from thence they sailed to Cyprus." Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for the safety of the journey today. We thank you for, Lord, just the experiences today, Lord, just to see what you're doing here in this place. Lord, we have prayed for and known about this church for many, many years, but Lord, it is just a blessing to be able to see the folks here, because a church is not a building. It's not pews. It's not carpeting. Lord, a building is born again, baptized believers, gathered together for the purpose of Christ. And so, Lord, we're excited to be able to be here to be a part of this. We've heard many of the stories. We've shared many of the prayer requests, many of the concerns. And Lord, we want to see you plant this church, and we're excited about you planting another church here in the city of Philadelphia through this local church. And so, Lord, we just pray that the few moments we share tonight, that we'd be able, through the Word of God, to be an encouragement and a blessing to these folks now. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. You know, the word congregation simply means a group of people assembled for religious worship. There are all kinds of congregations doing all kinds of things across our nation today and around the world. But commission means an act of granting certain powers or authority to carry out a particular task or duty. You know, and Jesus said in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18, "All power is given unto me in heaven and earth." And then he says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded." Jesus said, "I take the authority that I have, and I give you a commission, I give you a command, I give you something that you have authority from God Himself to carry out and to do." Amen. So, a commissioned congregation is a church which has received and understood their marching orders. Let's just bring it down where it's easy to understand.
Yeah.
Do we understand our marching orders? Have we received them, and do we understand them? Now think about this. Within 40-day period between the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, there was five different occasions where he said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel." He said it at the end of the book of Matthew. He said it in the book of Mark, the book of Luke, the book of John, and then we said in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. And so he uses terms like all nations, every creature, the uttermost, clarifying to them that they were to have a world view concerning the gospel.
Amen.
And so we see that they have a clear command and marching order. Now it's interesting, in Acts chapter 9, verse 31, the Bible says something here. It says, "Then," and "then" means after Saul, who was persecuting the church, got saved.
Right.
He went back to Jerusalem for a period of time, and then he preached a while and got some people upset, and then the brethren sent him back to Tarsus, where he spends a few years there, I'm assuming, studying and preparing for what God's going to do with him. But at the "then" means Saul has been converted, and Saul is no longer persecuting the church, the early church. And so it says this in verse 31, "Then had the," listen, churches, plural, "rest throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria, and were edified and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Ghost, were multiplied." Now, I don't know if that means the churches were multiplied in number or the number of churches was multiplied, but there were churches, they were multiplied. And if you know Palestine back in that day, the Promised Land, there was Galilee in the north, there was Samaria in the center, and there was Judea down south where Jerusalem was. And all three of those areas of the Promised Land had churches there. But it's interesting that in 17 years, because that is the time frame of what we just read in Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 4, in 17 years, only two churches of all the churches in Galilee, Samaria, and Judea, only two churches are named by name. Now, by that interest, 17 years, there's all these churches, but they're two named by name. And I want to discuss those for a few moments tonight. One would be called the Mother Church. Jerusalem certainly was the mother. By God's divine design, He said, go and wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And they went and they prayed and waited for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And God chose the Old Testament, put His name in the city of Jerusalem. And He continues to do it in the church age by allowing the church at Jerusalem to be the first assembly of God's people. 120 are gathered together, waiting on the promise, praying for the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes and empowers the early church in Acts chapter 2. And so the mother church, which we would say is Jerusalem, you see in Acts chapter 1 through Acts chapter 7, it grew from 120. Remember 120 praying in chapter 1? It grew to 3,120, 3,000 saved on the day of Pentecost. And then you go into Acts chapter 3 and chapter 4, and through some preaching and some things that happened, 5,000 more get saved. Yeah. Those are some pretty good meetings. Yes, but you get to chapter 5, and the Bible says they were getting saved multitudes that couldn't even count them. So this was by that time a mega church. The mother church became a mega church in the matter of days.
Right.
Now they had marching orders. They had their commission five times between the time that Jesus resurrected until He sent them back up there. Five times He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And so Jerusalem's seeing great things happening there in the city. Then in Acts chapter 8, chapter 7, we know about Stephen. Stephen preaches, Stephen's stoned. He's the first martyr of the early church. But in chapter 8, something begins to happen that's a little bit different. And these events in chapter 8 are between 4 to 7 years after Pentecost. 4 to 7 years after they got their marching orders. And it has been, and Jesus gave the Great Commission and He gave the Holy Spirit to carry out those marching orders. And so men were scattered, not sent. Not on purpose, but by plan, but through persecution, they were sent. Acts chapter 8, verse 1 says this. Now the church has had great growth. Multitudes have been saved. In chapter 6, they...